Coming to the application of stacks, the first application that we have already discussed is the stack frames. If you remember when we did recursion and we said when there are function calls, the function calls the activation record for each function which carries the parameters, the argument variables, the return address, other local variables and temporaries that you have, that is stored in a data structure and that is pushed into the stack. So all that information is in a structure, you can just imagine it like that, and then all of that, when the function call is made, all of that is pushed into the system stack. And then another call is made, whether it's recursion or general, the previous call from where you leave to go to the next function call, its context is pushed into the stack. And the stack grows. When you return from a function, you pop out the last entry, resume that context for that function, and resume your program. So activation, that's known as an activation record. So any function call will involve a stack where all that activation record is pushed. Okay. Another simple application is reversing a string. If I have a string hello, a string of characters, I'll use a stack which can hold one character each. I will scan the string and push all the alphabets one by one in the stack, which you see here. And this is how your stack grows upwards. Okay. Once the string ends, you hit the null at the end of the string. You pop one by one and print it. So I pop 0 and I print it. Then I pop L and I print it. So you push hello and you can pop it out in the reverse direction. Okay. And then you get the reverse of a string. So if you have a string and you have a ready stack data structure, push everything onto that and then pop everything out and you have the reverse. Balancing of symbols. Just like you have a function call and then you return. When you write a program, if main calls XYZ, then XYZ has to return back to main and then main has to exit. That's when your program will be complete. Okay. So similarly, when you have a function call, that function context is pushed into the stack. When you return, that is pulled out and there'll be nothing in the stack once you finish. Similarly, your symbols in a program, whenever you write an equation, you put brackets, opening and closing brackets. They have to be in proper order so that your equation is legal. Okay, so what we do, rather what the system does, when it encounters an equation which has a lot of parentheses, it starts pushing each symbol onto the stack. So I'll just draw a stack like this. Okay. And the first symbol to go inside will be this. This is the opening bracket. Then this will be your next symbol that will go inside the stack. That is this one. Once you encounter a closing bracket, whichever form it is, square bracket or curly brackets, you pop out the last entry in your stack and you compare whether what was inside the stack and what you have encountered, they are the same type of brackets, and one should be an open bracket and the other one should be a closed bracket. So this will be taken off, so it's balanced. Okay, then after that, since this is gone here, then you'll encounter this. This is a closing bracket. You will pop out this and match it with this closing bracket. So you should get a match and then your stack will be empty. Okay, if your stack is empty at the end of your equation, whatever you have written, then your equation is balanced as the parentheses are balanced. If in this case you had something like this, so you would have pushed like this one first, then you would have pushed this one first, and then you encounter the closing square bracket. So you pop out this entry here. So So this is popped out and it is matched with this. So there are two different types of opening and closing brackets. It will be a mismatch. So once it is a mismatch, your system tells you that there is an error in your program. Your compiler, when you compile your program, these kind of errors will be detected and you will be informed to make the changes accordingly. Okay, so you can see here, this is the same thing that I just mentioned. These are the steps. You push the opening braces to the stack and you pop once you encounter any kind of closing bracket. Then you match this closing bracket with what is at the top of the stack, which you will get using pop. And you have ASCII values for these, so the opening and closing will be matched accordingly. And in case of a mismatch, it will be informed by the compiler and then you have to make the necessary changes. The next application is of the calculation of postfix expressions. So what we are used to, the type of expressions that we write when we do general mathematics, they are known as infix expressions. Why? Because you have the operator in between the operands A and operand B. Okay, so infix, when the operand is between the operator, sorry, when the operator is between the operands. If the operator is before the operands, this is known as prefix notation, also known as Polish notation. Then you have the postfix, where the operator, it appears after the operands. This is known as suffix or reverse Polish notation, and this is what is usually used in your compilers. So usually, like it's mentioned, it's a universally accepted notation for designing your ALU or your CPU, the arithmetic logic unit and the central processing unit. It understands basically postfix expression. So what happens when you write an expression in your program, which is an infix, because that is what you understand, internally it is converted into a postfix expression and then it is evaluated. We'll see more of that. These are all applications of stack. So first of all, you can convert infix into postfix using stacks. Then you can evaluate the postfix expression using stacks. So in infix notation, we usually use the BODMAS rule. So what operator will be applied first? So you should know the BODMAS rule to apply that. Okay. And similarly, when you do postfix evaluation, we have something known as the operator precedence. Okay. That has to be taken care of once you do postfix evaluation. Okay. We'll get into detail of what this prefix, postfix, infix is, how we convert these notations and how we evaluate using stacks and how we convert from infix to postfix to prefix on paper as well. So the next application is constructing expression trees. We'll do more of expression trees later when we actually do trees, which is a non-linear data structure. But for now, you can just remember that when you have an infix expression A plus B, you can represent it in the form of a tree. Now, normally your tree grows like this and then it goes upwards. Okay. So you have the root here and this is the leaf and the branches. But here in computer science, the tree grows in the downward direction. You have the root here and these are the branches that go down and these are called the leaf nodes. Okay, so it's the other way down, upside down. So your expressions can be constructed into an expression tree. Why we construct expression tree, you'll see later. It is easy to get your infix, postfix, prefix expressions from the expression tree based on how you traverse the tree. So all these terms, maybe you not understand right now, you'll get into details of these once we do trees. Okay, for now just remember, when we have an expression tree, the internal nodes they are connected either to another internal node or to leaf. So the operands will be the leaf nodes, and the internal nodes are the operators. Okay, your plus and multiplication. So how do we construct an expression tree? Just an overview right now. We first convert our infix into postfix notation. So a plus b is ab plus. Then we scan the string and push it into our stack. So we push the operands in the stack. So push a and push b. Once we encounter any operator, we pop out the last two elements that are in the stack, which is your, once you pop out the first element, it will be b. Once you pop out the second element, it will be a. Then we apply this operator on these two and calculate the answer. So the order in which we apply is pop 2, operator, pop 1. So this order has to be remembered. If you do pop 1, operator, pop 2, that will give you a wrong answer in case you are doing division or power. Okay. Another application is that we use stacks when we do backtracking or when we do depth first search in graphs. So more of this will come later once we actually get into graphs and backtracking. Okay, so we have to get into detail of this prefix, postfix and infix. Okay, so I've listed some examples and then we'll do one example in detail. So an infix of the form a plus b can be converted into prefix by writing the operator first and then the operands in sequence in which they appear. In postfix, we'll write ab and shift plus to the right hand side. For a simple one operator expression, it is easy. When you have multiple operators or something like this, we first do the internal calculations. For example, you have b into c. It is within the braces, so we'll resolve it first. So we are converting it into prefix. We put star bc, and in case we are converting it into postfix, we'll do bc star. So our equation is still not complete. It is still, this part is in infix notation. So next we'll treat this whole thing here. This is treated as the second operand. So now you have a plus this box. Okay, so for converting it into prefix, we'll put plus first, then we'll put a, and then we'll put this box, which is star bc. Similarly, now my expression is a plus this box, which contains bc multiplication. So it is a plus this box. So we'll write a, this box is my second operand, and then I write the operator. Okay, so this is the technique that we will use for more complicated expressions, which is coming up next. So I have this expression here, which is quite long. So you see there are brackets, there are square brackets, and within them there are round brackets. So what do we do? In case your parentheses are not there, you can put them so that you can evaluate in the order of BODMAS, because this right now we are doing this by hand. When a computer program does this to convert this expression from infix to postfix, they have their own defined rules then. So we parenthesize according to our BODMAS rules, then we convert the sub expressions to prefix or postfix, whatever you are doing, and then to make it a bit simpler, we rename the box which I spoke to you about in the earlier example. We will rename this box, for example, like p. So I am left with a plus p. So now it becomes a simplified expression, and then you can do plus ap or ap plus. Okay, so for longer expressions you need to write it down and do it in steps so that you do not go wrong anywhere. So this is the expression. Let me go up here. This 3 is my expression now. So what I do, I take the smaller parts, b into c, d plus e, and I convert them into prefix. So right now we're doing prefix notation. So this is my prefix of B into C. This is my prefix of D plus E. And then I rename them as P and Q. Okay. Then I rewrite the expression with this P and Q. So I am left with this. Okay. Now, again, within the brackets, I have Q into F. I'll convert that into prefix, rename it to R, and proceed. Now, you see, the expression is getting simplified. So, R divided by G, again, written into prefix and renamed as S. So, what I'm left with is A plus B plus S. So, addition, there's no Bodmer's rule. You can do A plus B first or B plus S first. If you do it differently, it doesn't matter, because it's just simple addition. So plus AP substituted with T, then I have T plus S, and this becomes plus TS. Okay, plus TS is my final expression. I just need to resubstitute whatever I have basically shortened. So I resubstitute T with its, or I substitute T with its previous value, which is plus AP. Then I substitute P and S. P is your star BC and S is slash RG. Then I have R and G. So this will be substituting R. R is star into QF. So this is actually R here. So you substitute it with star QF and you proceed. Your Q is plus DE. So, you replace it and this is your prefix expression. So, you go step by step. When you do it initially till you actually get the hang of it, replace the shorter expressions so that you just have one alphabet to deal with. That will help you do it correctly. Once you are experienced and a pro in this, then you can skip some steps and just proceed. Okay. So let's take the same example now and convert it into postfix. So again, I'm doing the same thing. I take the bracket ones first, do the calculation. This is my postfix expression for these two. Rename them as P and Q. Rewrite the equation. Convert the smaller ones into postfix. Rename, rewrite the equation. Convert to postfix, rename, rewrite the expression. Then again, convert to postfix, rename, and then rewrite the expression. Convert the new expression into postfix. And then go around substituting in the reverse order. So substitute T, then P and S, then R, then Q, and you land with the postfix expression. Now, there is a way in which you can actually check if your postfix expression that you have got at the end of all this exercise is right or not. And that method also uses stacks. Okay. So, I'll get to that later once we get done with these things. I'll show you how you can actually do that exercise and see. And see for yourself or check for yourself that your postfix expression is correct. Okay, so before we go there, if you have to write a program in which you have to convert infix into postfix, you don't want to do it manually, so you want to write a program to do this for you. Even that program will be using a stack. So what is the procedure? So when you enter an expression, okay, this one is from infix from postfix. Let's see, I'll get here. Let me first. Okay, let's. Okay, here you go. This is, let me, because I mentioned this first, so let me finish this here. If you have an infix expression with you and you want to convert it into postfix using a program, so what we do is we take the input as a string and we scan the string from left to right. When we encounter an operand, we put it in the output string, and if we encounter an operator, we put it in the stack. Okay, Then I encounter B, so I print it out. So now I got A and B. I get an operator, so I push it into the stack. Then C, I get A, B and C. And now I have a plus. So you can push into the stack, but there are some rules that are defined to do this job. When you try to push an operator plus over multiplication, so if you have A plus B into C, you don't do A plus B first, you do B into C first. So according to your BODMAS rule, multiplication is higher precedence than your addition. So the rule is that in the stack, an operator of lower precedence cannot sit on top of the operator of higher precedence. So right now you have plus here, and then you have multiplication. I draw it like a star. And now plus is trying to come on top. Plus is a operator of lower precedence than multiplication, so it cannot go on top of plus. So once you encounter such a situation, you pop out everything before 3, which is your plus, to output, and then push 3. So star or multiplication is popped out, it is put here. Then plus is popped out and it is put here. And then your this 3 plus is pushed into the stack. So going back here, now you have an opening bracket before D into E here. So even that is treated as a operator. So we push that into the stack. Then D and E and multiplication pushed into the stack. Now after D into E, again you have this plus. This will try to go on top of multiplication. So you will have to pop out everything. Now when you have a situation where you have an opening bracket, so when this kind of operator mismatch happens, you have to pop out everything till your, it's like a block, till this opening bracket, because I'm doing a sub expression calculation within the brackets. So when I say pop, because of this operator precedence mismatch plus coming, trying to come over multiplication, I pop out everything till the opening bracket, because I'm working in this block right now. So I'll pop out this multiplication, it will go here. Then there is F and the closing bracket. So I'll put F here in the output and put the closing bracket here. So once you encounter a closing bracket, that means you have closed or finished calculating this sub expression. Closing means you pop out everything. Basically, you pop out everything that is within the brackets and the brackets as well. So this plus comes here. Next you get, you have multiplication and G. Okay, multiplication goes, this plus is still here. Multiplication goes on top of that. Then you put G here. You hit the end of the string and you pop out everything and you put it here. So you calculate a postfix expression from infix expression. Okay. So calculation of postfix from infix using a stack. So you can write a program to actually do this for you. Now coming back to, we finished this postfix expression calculation. Now we have calculating infix from postfix. Now once you get your postfix expression, you want to check whether it's the correct postfix for this particular infix. So what do you do? So again, we use stack to do this check for us. So what do we do? These are the steps. I'll just read them out before we proceed to the example. Push the operands until you encounter an operator. So once you are reading this string, this is now your postfix string, you just push the operands into the stack until you encounter an operator. Once you encounter an operator, you pop out the last two elements, apply the operator. So if I encounter multiplication, I pop out B and C and multiply them together, and whatever answer, I push it back into the stack. Okay, so I will keep on doing this. Push the operands into the stack, and once I encounter an operator, pop out the last two, apply the operator, store the answer back into the stack till there's only one element left in the stack, and that one element is actually your answer. If the string is a string of actual numbers with A being some 1, 2, 3, A, B, C having some values, you'll see there'll be one number left at the end in the stack. And if it's a string, you'll see the actual infix expression that will be left at the end of the stack. So I've tried to show this in steps from left to right. So what are the steps? Push A, B, and C. These are operands. There go. Then you encounter a operator. You pop out the last two. So first C comes out, then B comes out. Like I said earlier, the first pop is C, the second pop is B. You have to do B into C. For multiplication, it won't matter, but for some power and division, it will matter. If you cannot do C divided by B, it's actually B divided by C. So the second pop into the first pop. So pop 2 into pop 1. Whatever answer you get, in this case, since B and C are not numbers, you get B into C. We push it back into the stack. So then you encounter a plus here. So what you do again, you do pop of the last two. What are the last two? A and B into C. So A plus B into C. So I'm just renaming it for as P for simplicity for now. So I push P back into the stack. Now I have P. And I read D, E into the stack. D, E. Okay, then I encounter a plus. Again, pop out the last two, D and E, and apply the operator, which makes it D plus E. Then proceed. Proceed, F comes next. It goes into the stack. You encounter the multiplication. So you pop out F and D plus E. So D plus E into F. I have put it to Q and put it back into the stack. Then P, Q, let's see what comes after. You have G and two more operators, division and plus. So I push G. So division comes. It's not G divided by Q, it is Q divided by G. The second pop divided by the first pop. And then you encounter a plus. Then you pop out these two, do P plus Q by G, and the value whatever is R. It is pushed into the stack. Now you're left with only one element in the stack. And what is R? R is P plus Q by G. What is P? P is A plus B into C. Q is D plus E into F divided by G. So this is your correct infix. In case you have done something wrong in your infix to postfix conversion, when you apply this method to your postfix to get your infix back, in case there's something wrong in the postfix expression, either you'll get a wrong expression, and most likely what will happen, you'll be left with more than one term in the stack and no operator left to apply it to them. Okay, so that will be a way of telling you that you have done something wrong in the conversion. So now if your postfix expression is actually some numbers. So when you write a postfix expression like this on paper, we assume that we only have single digit numbers. It cannot be 62, it is 6 and 2. So we'll proceed with that assumption, and we'll do the same what we did before in the example. So you push the operators 6, 2 and 3. You encounter plus, you pop out the last two, apply plus to them. 3 plus 2 is 5, push 5 back into the stack. Okay, then you encounter a subtraction. So again, you cannot do 5 minus 6, it is 6 minus 5. So it is pop 2 minus pop 1, which is 6 minus 5, 1. Then you push 3, 8, 2, you get division. Again, it's not 2 divided by 8, it is 8 divided by 2. So you get 4, push it back. You get a plus next. This is here. You add 4 plus 3, 7. You push it back, the answer in the stack. You encounter a multiplication after this. Multiply 7 into 1, which is 7. Put it back. You encountered a 2 after this, push it into the stack. Then you have this. This is the power. So it is 7 to the power 2, which is 49. The answer is pushed back. You encounter 3. Then you encounter plus. You add these two, you get 52. That is your resultant. So this is how, once in your system, your infix expression is converted into postfix expression. Once the variables in your expression get some values, they have to be evaluated, and this is how the evaluation will take place, and it will take care of the Bodmas rules are already taken care of, so you just have to do the evaluation. So this is the example we just did. I've mentioned the steps briefly. So what I want you to do as an exercise, this is for practice. I'll give you an exercise later on as your second assignment. Convert these postfix expressions both into prefix and postfix. Okay, for postfix expressions that you get in the end, check using stacks if your expression is actually correct. Okay, the way it is done in this lecture, I'll be posting these notes as well. So same for part 1 to 4, but do it for both prefix and postfix. And evaluation, or checking if your postfix is correct, that part you have to do only for the postfix expressions. And you also do this example where you have this postfix evaluation. So remember, if you have an this is for part 4. For part 4, if I write e to the power f divided by g, so you power has a higher precedence, you do not divide 2 by 8 first. You'll actually do power. It's actually like this, 8 to the power 2, sorry, this is 2 divided by 8. So it's not 8, 2 divided by 8. Okay, so it's 64 divided by 8. So remember that when you convert, you first have to convert this into your pre or postfix, and then apply this divided by g. Okay, so I'll leave this as an exercise for you, and this is almost what we cover in stacks. We'll be doing more of stacks when we actually get to trees and expression trees and depth first search in graphs. So for now, this is pretty much everything you need to know, but you need a lot of practice in this prefix, postfix, and evaluation. Even balancing of parentheses, you should be doing some examples. You can try it on some example and see. Using stacks, check if the parentheses of an expression are balanced or not. Okay, so I'll end this lecture here. Thank you.